COVID-19 has come at a cost for many small businesses, but financial support is available from the Government of Ontario. From grants of up to $20,000 for eligible small businesses, to support for purchasing PPE, to rebates for property tax and energy costs, we are working to ensure our small businesses can keep employing people and serving our communities, now and when COVID-19 is behind us. Visit ontario.ca/COVID support to apply. Paid for by the Government of Ontario. COVID-19 has come at a cost for many small businesses, but financial support is available from the Government of Ontario. From grants of up to $20,000 for eligible small businesses, to support for purchasing PPE, to rebates for property tax and energy costs, we are working to ensure our small businesses can keep employing people and serving our communities, now and when COVID-19 is behind us. Visit ontario.ca/COVID support to apply. Paid for by the Government of Ontario.
Hello, nerds. This is Jesse from Rock Sugar, and you're listening to the Geekcast Radio Network. Keep it right here.
There is nothing wrong with your podcast player. Do not attempt to adjust the volume. Hello and welcome back to our studio. You are now inside Studio 2009. I'm, of course, TF2 and Mike. And joining me for the first time is not Steve Megatron. It is Mike, the Birdman. Hello, sir.
That's right. I have returned from lands beyond. And
it's interesting that you're here now because you're going to be here later at some point. Because normally inside Studio 2009, we don't have guest hosts on until after they do their podcast approach. But that's a whole other story. But Mike is here because we are starting something I have wanted to do since, quite frankly, 1983 when I was 3 years old. I wanted to watch the Star Wars movies in order, in story order, folks. So over the next 12 months, at least the 9 of the next 12 months, you're going to have one episode a month dedicated to all 9 of the Skywalker saga movies. Holy crap.
We should talk about Rogue One and Solo too at some point, because those are actually, you know what? The more I watch Solo, the more it sticks with me, and Rogue One is a friggin' gem of a movie, but that's another discussion for a different day.
Yeah, I've ever since I was a kid, ever since I saw the original Star Wars, now technically known as Episode 4, A New Hope, I'm like, wait, Chapter 4? Where are the other 3 chapters? What's going on here? I didn't know. I was a kid in the 80s. I had no clue. You know, and ever since then, I've always wanted to, and ever since especially Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, I've always wanted to do them in story order. Well, now that the Skywalker saga is quote-unquote complete, because episode 9 is here as well, we're doing them in story order, and I'm sure we will dedicate an episode of the show for Solo and Rogue One. I do remember watching Rogue One when it first hit, I don't know, like Redbox or something, and at the time I just wasn't into it. The best thing was the ending. But that was just me, I guess. So we have both rewatched Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. This is my second time watching it ever.
Refer to the prophecy of the one who will bring balance to the Force. You believe it's this boy?
He can see things before they happen.
He can help you.
The Force is unusually strong with him.
He was meant to help you. Anakin! Tell him to take off!
Will I ever see you again?
What does your heart tell you?
Are you sure about this? Trusting our fate to a boy we hardly know?
Anakin Skywalker, meet Obi-Wan Kenobi.
I sense much fear in you.
The boy is dangerous. They all sense it. Why can't you?
Fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to suffering.
I think for me, this is probably, it's less than 10, but more than 5, because I saw it in the theaters. I think I saw it twice or three times. I've seen it a few times on Blu-ray, and I streamed it last night in 4K on Disney Plus. And I was actually surprised it wasn't a more exciting experience in 4K, like, because I'm watching it on a 60-inch TCL. I've got a Dolby 5.1 surround setup with Dolby Atmos, and I was paying attention to certain scenes, and I was really hoping the pod race would really pop, and it did, and it didn't. I remember in the theater, it was a much more visceral experience, because obviously you're seeing it on this gigantic screen with like 500 other people, but I don't know. I was expecting more technically, but I was just realizing how bad some of the CGI looks from back then to now. Like, although that being said, Yoda, like the version that's on Disney Plus, I don't know whether this is the same version that was on the 2011 Blu-ray. If that was the Yoda from episodes 2 and 3, the one on Disney Plus, they replaced the Yoda puppet with the new CGI model from episodes 2 and 3.
Interesting.
So it looks more. Yeah, so it looks more consistent. Because I was watching it last night thinking, something don't look right. So I went back and did a little bit of research. And I'm thinking, huh, so I was right. There's a great photo floating around out there somewhere. Someone took a picture of the Lucasfilm archives. And there's a picture of the Yoda puppet who's kind of rotting because it was made out of rubber and latex and all those kind of materials. And it's cross-eyed and it looks like it's dying. So yeah, there's that nightmare fuel.
Good Lord.
For you.
All right. So most people know all this stuff, but just some quick, just the facts. Written and directed by George Lucas, produced by Rick McCollum, starring Liam Neeson, Ewan McGregor, Natalie Portman, Jake Lloyd, Ian McDiarmid, Anthony Daniels, Kenny Baker, Frank Oz. The music was done by John Williams. Release, and I find this funny, I guess, but they used to do this back then. I think they still do it now. It had a Los Angeles release May 16th of 99, and the U.S. world premiere release was May 19th, 1999. 22 years ago this May, this movie is 22 years old this year. Holy crap.
Yeah, I remember a lot of the hype for this. I remember a lot of the marketing kind of leading up to this, because this is when the internet, where I was frankly shit. So I was downloading materials on a 26.4 BBPS modem. Let me tell you, you don't know how long it takes to download something until you're on a dial-up connection. And I remember downloading the trailer the second this came online. I remember watching Entertainment Tonight before we got Entertainment Tonight Canada, where they showed little bits of the trailer. I remember people were buying tickets. I can't remember what movie it was for, but people would buy tickets to watch the trailer for episode 1 and then walk out. So they'd buy the tickets to some stupid like Meg Ryan movie and then just ditch. So some movies made tremendous bank off of this trailer.
Captain.
Yes, sir.
Tell them we wish to board at once.
With all due respect, the ambassadors for the Supreme Chancellor wish to board immediately.
Yes, of course. As you know, our blockade is perfectly legal, and we'd be happy to receive the ambassadors.
Do you want me to talk about my experience with this? Because
sure, absolutely.
This is one of the times I skipped school and didn't get in shit. Okay. So when this movie came out, I had to camp out for tickets. This is before the era, really in Canada anyway, of online kind of ticket sales, especially for small towns. So my town was about 20,000 people. We had, I think at that time it was Owen Sound Cinemas 5, maybe 3. I'm pretty sure it was 5. Yeah, it was 5. So in this dirt mall that was that's long since been destroyed and been replaced with this huge multiplex, I told my teacher, all my teachers that day, I'm not going to be in class tomorrow. Why? Star Wars. Really? Yeah, Star Wars. One of my teachers, Mr. Bain, said, all right, Mike, I'm not going to mark you absent, but there's a catch. What's the catch? You save me a seat. No problem. So I went, I took the school bus in the town because I wasn't going to tell my parents that I was doing this. They fucking knew. So I went in line at, I think it was 8:30 in the morning. I was not the first person in line. I think I was number 5. So I sat in line and then my friends started trickling in from all across the town and surrounding counties. So by about 10 o'clock, there was about a group of, I want to say between 6 to 10 of us. And at that time, I was playing the Star Wars role-playing game from West End Games. Wizards of the Coast had taken over the license, would take it on a little bit later, I think after Attack of the Clones or just a little bit before. But so we're sitting there in line. We're playing Star Wars, the role-playing game. We don't know what to expect. We're kind of speculating. I remember one of my friends at the time, Matt, had bought one of those candy Darth Maul lightsabers. And we thought it was the coolest thing ever. So we get to thinking, oh man, we're friggin' hungry. And because 1999, I'm the only one that has a like cell phone. So I've got this Zach Morris brick cell phone called the local Domino's Pizza. And they're like, okay, where do I deliver this thing to? I'm like, okay, I want you to go to the Owen Sound Cinemas 5 and look for the fat kid in the Star Wars t-shirt. And they're like, what? And I'm like, yeah. So they come deliver pizza for me and all my friends.
Wow.
And we're sitting there eating pizza. We're talking with like other Star Wars fans. We're probably about middle of the pack in terms of like age. There were some younger fans there. They were mostly older. But we were some of the only high school kids. So we're sitting there and probably by about noon to 3 o'clock, the line starts getting bigger and bigger. And I think when the theater opened at 6 o'clock, I think the line was easily 200 or 300 people. And my teacher strolls up at about 4:35 o'clock. He's like, wow, you really did save me a seat. I'm like, yeah. So we go into the theater. Now, before you went in, you could pay $10 and get a memorial or whatever theater booklet, which was like 50 or 60 pages, kind of like a coffee table size, but it was like high glossy kind of paper, but it wasn't bound like a book, of all the production stuff for like Star Wars Episode 1. So I skipped it. You can buy these things on eBay for like $10 now, I think. So we go in there. Because we were so close to the front of the line, we got really good seats. We were like fourth or fifth row in, right dead center in the middle. No tall guys beside us. Sat in there. I don't think I had a girlfriend at the time, but I think my best friend Ryan at the time was there, and my friend Jared and Mr. Bain and all of them. And we sat there, and for the next 2 hours and I think 16 minutes, it was something else. And seeing it for the first time, I was like, okay, some of this was really cool. I mean, everybody loved Darth Maul, though he deserved better and ultimately got better as the years and expanded universe kind of filled out his backstory in Clone Wars, Rebels, whatever. And it was fun. I mean, everybody remembers corn on the cob, which became the meme from Duel of the Fates. But that fight scene, everybody was really excited. The pod race scene was really cool, though admittedly a little long. And it was something else. And although I remember seeing it when the first Episode 1 crawl came up, and they're talking about taxation of trade routes, I'm thinking, Well, okay, sure, I guess. It just wasn't what we were used to, because we were used to seeing, like, the Galactic Empire, the Senate has fallen, and all this other shit. We're talking about what is essentially a day in Congress here that just happens to end badly.
What's so funny about that is that when I went to rewatch this movie, I saw all the U.S. politics in this movie.
It's true. Especially, like, there's one line Palpatine says in this. He's like, "And now you see the real power of the Senate. Enter the bureaucrat," or something along those lines. And I'm thinking, yeah, if that isn't echoing some things that used to happen under your previous administration, I don't know what is. And I was fairly pleased seeing this movie, but then the Phantom Menace kind of showed its head, and I started to dislike this movie upon second and third viewings, because I saw it in theaters a few times. I think I took my girlfriend at the time. I took a couple friends, and the episode one coolness just kind of wore off after a while, but it was one of those things that it's gotten better with time now that I've kind of went back and rewatched it, especially for this podcast. But I've got some thoughts and feelings, but I've been rambling on long enough, but I do want to talk about the marketing, the toys and everything else. A lot.
We will get to that. So here's my history with it. It's one of those things where from, I want to say 87 to 97, I coveted the three VHS versions of the original trilogy. There are three specific VHS covers that were the covers at the time. And I absolutely loved it. So when I heard about this, I was like, ooh, cool. And at the time, this was May of 99. Oh, geez. This came out the 19th. I was 9 days away from graduating high school a year late. It's a long story. I got flunked in eighth grade for health and PE. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. That's all history under the bridge. At the time, I had to actually recommit to the state of Kentucky, because I was in the state of Kentucky's care. When you turn 18, you are, you know, see you later, kid. You know, go do your thing. I had to actually recommit in order to graduate high school. So I was still in the state-run facility that I had been in since 97. And one of the counselors said, "Hey, Star Wars." And I'm like, "Oh, yeah, I remember episode one." I'm like, "Wait, what? They're finally putting out a first episode?" "Sure." So we go to the theater. We have fun. I remember nothing about being in that theater. Nothing at all. Have no clue. I just remember the fact that we went, I think, the Saturday it came out. So, you know, the day after it came out and all of that. I only ever saw it then. And when we rewatched, like, I honestly do not remember watching Phantom Menace in the last 22 years, other than as of this recording last night when I rewatched it for this podcast. Have no clue in the last 22 years if I had seen this film before. All as I remember is everybody hating on it and hating the kid and hating the this and hating the midichlorians this and this, that, and the other thing and whatever else and all that. That's all I really remember. And then the two things I remember most about this film are the pod race scene and the Duel of the Fates lightsaber battle at the end. There's a question in here of in our script that we were using here, folks. What level of fan were you heading into the prep work for this record? I have, now that we live in an age where Disney Plus is a thing and everything Disney owns, because Disney owns everything, is online and streaming, I have actually been watching The Clone Wars. I'm up to season 4, episode 14 or something or other. So I've been binging through The Clone Wars animated series from 2008 and all this and all that. And I love Star Wars, but it's never been my number one, but I still do love it. So in prep for this, Mike, how much of a fan were you of the franchise going into this?
Okay, so my history with Star Wars goes back very much to the 1980s. I had a neighbor I would borrow Return of the Jedi from. I saw A New Hope a bunch of times on Cinemax on my satellite dish. And I didn't see Empire a whole lot just because it was never on in like repeats, but I loved it. So in the early 90s, I can't remember precisely how this happened, but I started reading the Star Wars Expanded Universe books in like the summer of 93, 94. It was just after I graduated grade 8, before I went in the high school, and they were the Timothy Zahn books that is known as the Thrawn trilogy. And I started really getting back into Star Wars. And then when they announced the new special editions were coming back to theaters, me and my friend Wayne and Jarrett would go to the theaters to go like see these movies every time. And again, the first kids in line, because we'd go to the theater 2 or 3 hours before the movie started, because the theater would open at 6, the movie would start at 7, we'd show up around 4. So we'd go, and I started getting into it. Then I met another kid in grade 10, I think it was, maybe it was grade 9, and his name was James, and he was a big Star Wars nerd. But the thing that got me into it was the Star Wars role-playing game from West End Games, second edition, revised. I got obsessed with it because at the time, my only role-playing experiences was Advanced Dungeons and Dragons, and I didn't really like it then, and Vampire the Masquerade, second edition, I think. And Star Wars, like, I know this universe. I know these characters. I know these stats. And I started picking up source book after source book after source book, and me and my friends Ben, Brad, Matt, I think one of my girlfriends played with us, and we play Star Wars every single day at lunch for like a year and a half. Memorable things was burning down the entirety of the forest moon of Endor with a thermal detonator, nuking Boba Fett at one of the spaceports, because at that time, Star Wars N64's Shadows of the Empire had just come out. So I'm thinking, I want to use this source book from West End Games. And we killed Boba Fett. And just all these ridiculous and stupid adventures in Star Wars made me obsessed. And at the time, Kenner was still making the toys, and they were doing Power of the Force 2 or Power of the Force 1. I think it was Power of the Force 2. And those were known as the buff figures, where Princess Leia looks like she could take on Brock friggin' Lesnar. Because the sculpting was terrible, but the vehicles were great. So Lucasfilm had done this wonderful push with Shadows of the Empire, which was considered then an exciting thing, because it was a multimedia property that would be considered canon. What happened between Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi, and that got me more and more in the Star Wars. So I had the toys, I had all this crap, I had the things that I treasure the most was a Return of the Jedi Luke lightsaber from Power of the Force 2. I had a Han Solo blaster, which was the orange one, that was based upon the one from the 70s, but this one had better sounds. It was a better sculpt for the toy. And a Stormtrooper blaster from A New Hope. And I just really got into everything Star Wars for the longest time. I didn't really get into the films, like the film's history and background, until much, much later. I was more into the expanded universe. And then I started reading the Kevin J. Anderson books, which was his Jedi Academy stuff. One of my favorite books as a kid was a book. I think the author's name was Dave Wolverton. And this is a book that I don't think liked very much in the Star Wars Legacy or Legend series books. And it was called The Courtship of Princess Leia. And it shows how Han and Leia got together, where Han wins a planet in a card game. But the Rebel Alliance wants this guy from, I think it's called the Hapian Cluster. It's somewhere near the Unknown Regions. And they pledge their ships and their fleets to the Rebel Alliance so they can defeat the Empire. But the catch is that she has to marry this Prince Hapian, but he's a piece of shit. So this actually ties into the Clone Wars later on, because that book introduces the idea of the Night Sisters and Dathomir and the Zabrak, I think it is, which Darth Maul's a part of.
COVID-19 has come at a cost for many small businesses, but financial support is available from the Government of Ontario. From grants of up to $20,000 for eligible small businesses, to support for purchasing PPE, to rebates for property tax and energy costs, we are working to ensure our small businesses can keep employing people and serving our communities, now and when COVID-19 is behind us. Visit ontario.ca/COVID support to apply. Paid for by the Government of Ontario. COVID-19 has come at a cost for many small businesses, but financial support is available from the Government of Ontario. From grants of up to $20,000 for eligible small businesses, to support for purchasing PPE, to rebates for property tax and energy costs, we are working to ensure our small businesses can keep employing people and serving our communities, now and when COVID-19 is behind us. Visit ontario.ca/COVID support to apply. Paid for by the Government of Ontario.
So that book really set up a lot of stuff that would happen in Star Wars canon later, which I always thought was really cool. And then I just kept reading as many of the Expanded Universe books as I could. I read part of the X-Wing books by Michael Stackpole. I read, there were two books I friggin' hated, but they were so weird. I remember one called The Dark Saber. Mm-hmm. And I seem to remember one of the characters that was introduced in the Thrawn trilogy shooting somebody with the stun setting of her blaster. And I think the Jedi was like, well, I can't block that because the stun setting is rings that eject from the gun. And like, how do you block that? And then one book, this book was fucking terrible. And I think it was called Children of the Jedi, or it was Crystal Star, but it was just so boring. And I think it was Del Rey Books at the time. If you could write Star Wars, and if you could write Luke Skywalker did X, you got a book deal. And it didn't matter. I read that crap because I wasn't reading anything else. It was so bad. But you got cool characters like Mara Jade and Talon Card, Kip Duran, who is ultimately the ultimate Mary Sue because he had a weapon called the Sun Crusher that could blow up solar systems. It was so ridiculous. But yeah, like I was deep in the Star Wars fandom for a very long time. And I stayed into the fandom pretty hardcore up until college in 2006. When I kind of stepped away to focus on my studies, but at the height of my fandom around 2005, I was a moderator and the public relations agent for a fairly prominent Star Wars website at the time, dealing specifically with FX Sabers. I was known on Yoda's News. I was known on RebelScum.com because I would do a lot of trading and stuff like that. And I would just post in every thread that I possibly could. Actually, Star Wars led me to podcasting. In a very, very, very real way, there are these two podcasters named Arnie and Marjorie Carvello who started a podcast called Star Wars Action News. And that was the first podcast I ever listened to, starting back in 2004 and 2005.
For me, I was a fan, but I wasn't in it as much as you. I had never read any of the books at the time back, you know, 22 years ago. I knew of the toys, but I never really had any of the toys because honestly, none of the toys really, like, for me at the time, I was 19 when Phantom Menace came out, and I was growing up. I hadn't had action figures in years, and I wouldn't actually have an action figure collection until probably 2005, 2006, somewhere around there. But I still loved what I saw. I still enjoyed what I did, and I'm enjoying what parts of the fandom I'm getting into now with, you know, again, for me right now, as almost 41 years old, because we're recording this like, I don't know, a week and a half before my birthday. It's one of those things where as a kid, I needed my toys to transform back and forth. As an adult, I don't. I'm perfectly fine with a Star Wars Funko Pop that doesn't do much, let alone, you know, have action figure battles or whatever. Getting into the film breakdown, now we have several things here. We have highlights and lowlights of the film, favorite character moments, favorite special effect, pacing of the film, and favorite characters, main recurring guest, whatever. For me, highlights and lowlights, going back and watching this for the second time ever, I forgot how good Ewan McGregor was as Obi-Wan in this movie specifically, even though he's still technically a Padawan. He's not a Jedi yet. Obviously, he doesn't become a Jedi until the end of this film. But I forgot how good he was as young Obi-Wan because, again, folks, this came out after we saw old and decrepit Obi-Wan. Well, he wasn't so decrepit, but you get what I mean. You know, so that's a highlight. I do enjoy the pod racing scene, but it's not... I don't think the special effects for it have held up over the years, sadly. Lowlights, midichlorians, really? Organisms inside our organisms, really? Come on. That's a little wackadoo. And I couldn't, I wanted to just shoot Watto. I hate that guy.
I'd say for me, highlights of this film is, this is going to be a little bit showing sort of my film nerd side, costuming and props. Cause I think in a very, very real way, episode one set the tone for a lot of future Star Wars properties moving forward, because we're seeing the old Republic as it's starting to downfall, but you're also seeing a lot of elaborate costumes. You're seeing more aliens on screen. You're seeing more elaborate aliens on screen, because obviously they wanted to push Jar Jar as this big CG character who could interact with other people. And that really changed Star Wars fundamentally forever, because he would kind of change how Hollywood would like kind of do digital characters.
Mm-hmm.
But the costuming for this movie is astounding. Like Princess Amidala's, like almost every scene she's in, except when she's in like her handmaiden's outfit, and even then it's still gorgeous looking. It's her palace outfit that I don't like. It's the brown with the yellow trim outfit.
Right.
Looks fantastic. It's textured. I remember there was a book that came out in the early 2000s where it had costume swaths where you could touch the fabric of everything. And I remember, and I think I remember this right. So maybe I hope I didn't invent this late memory, but I remember seeing Chancellor Palpatine's robe, Chancellor Valorum, stuff like that, and just looking at how that looked and felt. Also, the weapons from this movie I remember being rather cool. Like, I've always been a big fan of the battle droid blaster because it looked different than the stormtrooper blasters. And that's another thing too. I liked the look of the battle droids. I mean, they weren't as iconic as stormtroopers. And I think that's the big problem is this series, like the prequel trilogy, never had a truly iconic droid. I think you could probably make an argument for the destroyer droids, maybe the super battle droids, but the regular rank and file battle droids was whatever. Another highlight for this for me, obviously, the music for Duel of the Fates. And while I was watching this, I was just paying attention to how Duel of the Fates played out, because that's also happening at the same time as the battle in space above Naboo against the droid control ship, and how it would swell and fall with that battle, and then going back to Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon fighting Maul, stuff like that. I'm trying to think of what else would be a really good thing I really enjoyed about this. Liam Neeson, I wish had been in one more movie. Even as like a force ghost, that would have been nice, but I can see why they didn't kind of lean into that.
Yeah.
I would say another highlight for this, the pod racing scene, I really do like, cause there's some really interesting sounds mixed into that. And I paid attention to it last night. When you hear Sebulba's pod racer specifically, it reminds me of the Clone Wars gunship. And I would wonder if they were mixed very, very, very similar. Like they sound like a certain brand of American helicopter, mixed with, some like other stuff. Also, vehicle design in this movie does not get enough credit. Like anything from Naboo has this very elegant look to it. And the Naboo Starfighter was the star vehicle for this movie because it was in so much of the marketing.
Oh yeah.
But I wish we'd seen it more throughout the trilogy. Like that should have been the X-Wing for this series. But instead we got the Jedi Starfighter, which you only ever see those in two movies and not for very long, but
yeah, no,
The Royal Cruiser, I thought looked fantastic. You don't see much of Darth Maul's Sith infiltrator, but I thought it was neat.
Yeah.
And ultimately, a big highlight, Darth Maul himself. He was cool, didn't do much, but he looked cool. And that's kind of a low for me, too, is you introduce the idea of the rule of two for the Sith. And you don't do much with Darth Maul. He just gets chopped in half. He says maybe five words, and that's the end of it. And Ray Park then was awesome. Ray Park now, not so much. So it's... It was cool to see Jedi fighting in their prime because I think the stunt coordinator was a guy named Nick Galliard, I think, or something like that. So you're seeing all these hybrid styles of fighting with swords, how it's fast, it's rapid. It's kind of like, I think it's been described as like kendo, samurai, and like fencing and some other moves. So when you're in the heat of fighting, there's only ever one way to get out of it. It's like chess where you're constantly in check. So you have to react a certain way. And I've always appreciated the hyper intensity of the action when it comes to any scenes involving the Jedi, which I'll talk about that when I do episode 3 with you, because I know so much about that movie. It's sad. But yeah, episode 1 showed us Jedis in their prime. This is the first time we'd seen Jedi that weren't old men, young boys, or cyborgs. And it really showed what the Republic was capable of.
Yeah.
But it also, thing as a highlight, and you kind of have to read into it, you saw how the Republic was on its way out. Because the Republic was buried in bureaucracy, red tape. You've got thousands of member worlds. How do you expect to get a vote that's going to go 60-40 to pass anything against all these different races, all these different cultures? The Republic was too big to sustain itself. And the Confederacy of Independent Systems, which would be introduced in the second movie, the Trade Federation, that was going to happen, in my opinion, anyway. Someone was going to stand up to the Republic, be it through the Sith wanting to take control or some lunatic who had enough money and droids to make something happen. Regardless, this was going to happen sooner or later. Just Darth Sidious put this plan in motion years beforehand.
Yeah. And for me, because I had been watching Clone Wars, and Clone Wars takes place after the beginning of Clone Wars, season one, I think, takes place after this movie does, obviously. I think it does, if I remember correctly. When I rewatched this, I completely forgot about the no confidence, and I completely forgot about Chancellor Valorum altogether. Never even remembered it. Like, originally I thought, oh, we're starting this off with Sidious being, you know, Palpatine and the, you know, all that and already in charge. I completely forgot about the vote of no confidence and the whole politicking of it all. And you look at 22 years ago, where we were in politics. Yeah, it's not as bad as it was 4 years ago, but still. I'm going to say this right now. because I've been watching so much Clone Wars and I've seen so much Jar Jar at this point. Jar Jar Binks in this film, for me personally, I'm not going to speak for anybody else, not going to speak for the Geekcast Radio Network or anything like that. He is not a lowlight. He is a highlight because he is a character that, admittedly, sadly, is probably meant to be in there for the kiddie type character kind of thing. Because what child in 1999, age, let's say, 6 to 12, was really going to look at young Anakin Skywalker as the one that they could, you know, relate to? But at least Jar Jar was the fun kiddie type, you know, I almost want to say barf character because, you know, barf from Spaceballs.
I think the problem with Jar Jar, and it's not anything against the actor because, you know, he's only going to do what's written on the page, is they tried to make him a mascot and they tried to insert, in my opinion, a little too much humor into him and he became obnoxious. Now, as the character went on through the series and even into the expanded universe, and I just read this last night, there's a tie-in novel that happens after Return of the Jedi. They go back to Naboo and Jar Jar's living on the streets as a clown. And that's sad because it turns out after after the creation of the first Galactic Empire, people know it was Jar Jar who gave Chancellor Palpatine emergency powers to create the Army of the Grand Republic.
Right.
And that was seen as the fall of the Republic because now he's got this army. So he was banished and exiled from Gungan City again. Adults and Gungans in the city won't look him in the face. So what happens on Naboo, he's living on the streets being a clown and entertaining children. He meets an orphan who's all sorts of disfigured and they kind of become friends and they decide, hey, why don't we look out for each other? We're both outcasts. Nobody wants us. And him and Jar Jar go off and have their own adventure together that way. So Jar Jar is a tragic character because he's so naive in the movies. In Clone Wars, he becomes a little bit more competent. Like, he's not a terrible character. I think he got a really bad shake because Lucasfilm and Kenner, I guess, at the time, or was it Hasbro? I don't know. The toy companies really wanted to push, here, this is a cool toy. Please make him marketable. They wanted their own Chewbacca, their own Ewok that could talk. And I think that's the tragedy of Jar Jar, is you could have turned a potentially really funny character because Ahmed Best, in least in recent years, has really embraced Jar Jar. I think it was at Celebration 2019 or something. He came out to thunderous applause, and he's done his own voice as Jar Jar in multiple different series. One of my favorite bits he's ever done is they did a robot chicken. And this came out after Revenge of the Sith, after Anakin becomes Vader. Mm-hmm. And Jar Jar appears as a force ghost. And Anakin is trying to explain to Jar Jar that he's not Anakin Skywalker anymore, how he's Darth Vader. And Jar Jar's just not having it. He's like, oh, Annie, we're such friends. Look at me. I'm all blue and glowing, sparkly. And he's like, Jar Jar, go into the escape pod. The separatists are coming. He's like, oh, really? And then he launches Jar Jar into space or something. It's ridiculous. But yeah, like I think Jar Jar deserved a little bit better than what he got. But one of the weirdest things, and then I'll let you get back to this, Mike. Mm-hmm. There was a sucker. Like a actual lollipop where mm-hmm. you could pull back Jar Jar's head.
Ew.
And his tongue came out.
No, stop.
Yeah, stop. It was weird. It's one of the weirdest things I've ever seen outside of Star Wars dog food that came out in, like, I think 83. Ooh. It's just so weird.
Yeah, very. Okay, so character moments, favorite character moments. There's a ton in here. I like 3PO's surprise that his insides are on the outside. that he has no coverings. I thought that was a funny moment. This is going to be a running thing for me throughout the nine episodes that we do on the films.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when episode 4 came out and they're like, oh, well, the war, the Clone War, the this, the that, the past that these two characters have with 3PO and Art, like, they've been through so much. In the prequels, my love for R2-D2 could not grow any more than it already has, because we actually get to see R2 in action. Next time when we talk about episode 2, I will be gushing all over flying R2. I don't care what anyone says, because it's awesome. But I love R2 and how I forgot how he was found, how he basically was part of their unit's thing, and then he just kind of saves the day. So I love R2. I know you're a big fan of it, but I am not a big fan of the Duel of the Fates. Yes, I like the battle. I just think the space battle was more... I was more intrigued to what this kid in this starfighter who doesn't know what the hell he's doing was going to do versus a lightsaber battle. And even on the second time watching through, I still found myself saying, hurry up and get to the end of this battle already with the lightsabers. I don't know what it is. I think it's because of the pacing that they put into that scene with the closing doors and the supposed tension they were trying to get out of it. It just made me want to fast forward through it. I didn't, but it made me want to do it.
I'd say for me, there's a scene, it's very, very, very small, but they're mostly involving Padme. So I think Natalie Portman is okay in this movie. I do like her in two specific scenes. There's two. The first scene is where she's cleaning R2 and she's talking to Jar Jar. There's just something about her mood and her mannerisms I really like in that scene. She's dressed in her handmaiden's outfit that I really like.
Mm-hmm.
And another scene is where Anakin essentially starts like hitting on her and he says, are you an angel? And just the look of what did you just say to me? That scene I really like. And another one is Obi-Wan comes out of the shaft with Qui-Gon.
I have a bad feeling about this.
The negotiations will be short.
I think this is on the droid control ship, and I think he says something along the lines of, well, the negotiations were short.
You were right about one thing, Master. The negotiations were short.
Yes, that's always a good line, yeah.
Yeah, like, Ewan McGregor has wonderful comedic timing, and he does capture a lot of what Alec Guinness kinda gave off in the original trilogy. Like, yeah, there's just enough humor there where it's not overpowering. It's not in your face, but it's a sly wink, and I like that about his character. And Qui-Gon one-on-one with Maul, I really like as well as a scene. Duel of the Fates I like for the most part, but I wish there hadn't been, as you mentioned, the doors with the energy that just, it breaks up the flow of the fight.
Yeah.
And I think when you look at Battle of the Heroes in episode 3, that's meant to be their Duel of the Fates. Cause I think they realized having a down moment like that in the middle of such a hyper kinetic scene kills the momentum. And I think Battle of the Heroes was an answer to say, you know what? I think we fucked up. Here's 20 minutes of actual Jedi fighting.
I think now, going back and thinking about it after watching it again, I think the thing that they were trying to do was show between the three characters. You got Maul, you got Qui-Gon, and then you got Obi-Wan way back in the back section there. Qui-Gon sits down and he's like Jedi meditating or Jedi mind tricking or whatever he's doing, but he's trying to show that he is not necessarily at peace, but he's calm in the moment. Whereas Maul is pacing, Obi-Wan's about ready to cut through the thing kind of thing. Like, they just want to get to the battle, because I don't know how old Maul was in this, but Obi-Wan was still a Padawan. So Obi-Wan was not a Jedi yet. So I could understand why a young Padawan learner would want to be so antsy in getting through these things. And I mean, I understand it now, but I still say that it just takes away from the overall fighting. And I'm glad that they have Battle of the Heroes when we get to episode 3.
Favorite special effect. What was your favorite effect in this?
I'd have to say the Starfighter stuff, I think, holds up the best.
Yep.
And then probably the lightsabers, because they do look different than they did in the original trilogy, and that's just the advancement of computer technology and kind of rotoscoping, which is how they used to do them way back in the day, and painting over the individual frames. This is different because it's actually CG, and I think it's stayed pretty consistent ever since then. Another special effect, again, I would call back to props and costuming, I think, is not to be understated, because there's an elegance to it. And I just want to make this point super, super quick. While I was watching Duel of the Fates last night, a lot of Naboo architecture, I think, has influenced Imperial stuff kind of later on, because I guess that's where Palpatine's from. He is from Naboo. And I'm just noticing the power reactor, and obviously it's meant to be a callback to the kind of Death Star and everything. But I got to thinking, wow, Naboo really has a utilitarian use to how their industrial stuff works, as opposed when you see the outside of Theed and the Royal Palace, it has a very rich and warm feeling to its architecture. But when it comes to its industrial stuff, it's very, okay, here it works. Sure, there's some blinky lights, but what you see is what you get. And I always thought that was kind of neat, how you see the consistency of Imperial design evolve through each movie.
Yeah, absolutely. And it probably is because Palpatine was from Naboo. At least he was from Naboo in this and whatever else. For me, I don't know. Like I said, the lightsabers, I agree with you. The costuming, yes. I like the droid effects. I didn't realize how much less of Roger Roger there is in this movie.
Check it out, Corporal. We'll cover you. Roger, Roger.
People always complain about the droids and Roger, 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 you know, all that and everything else. And I'm like, they actually talk more. They don't talk more, but they actually say other things other than just Roger, Roger, because what I noticed when rewatching this is that they're getting and giving orders to each other throughout the battle. And I was like, oh, that is kind of cool. All right. Pacing of this film overall,
I think it needs to be trimmed by about 15 minutes.
I agree, but I have to say on this second rewatch, and I'll fully say this and fully admit this, I did take breaks like for bathroom and that kind of thing, but I watched this consistently. Like, I didn't probably never stop watching this except maybe two different bathroom breaks, but it's one of those things where in the day and age where I can control the media, I don't have to worry about, you know, sitting in a theater for 2 hours and missing something or whatever. Like, I said to Karen, I said, oh, I have an hour and 42 minutes left of this film. And I was like, okay, well, I'm going to go check this. And there was like 47 minutes left. And I'm like, wait, what? How did that happen? I felt like, and I know this isn't really a pacing thing, it's more of a time thing, but I just felt like this film did not feel like the agonizing 2.5 hours that people think that it, people assume that it is. And the pacing of it, the only, like I said earlier, the only problems I had with it really is that lightsaber battle at the end. I didn't even have, normally I have problems with the back and forth, like switching scenes, like from the starfighter scene to the lightsaber scene, like that constant back and forth. But I didn't even have a problem with it then watching it.
I would agree. I like this movie wasn't as bad on the second rewatch in terms of pacing, though I would trim a few scenes here and there. I actually, one of the things I've been meaning to watch for years is there are various recuts of this movie. And I think, was it Tobey Maguire did a bunch? I think the guy who played Spider-Man did a bunch, or was it Elijah Wood? It was one of them. I can't remember who had done recuts of this movie, I think. And if I'm wrong, whatever. But I would trim some scenes on Tatooine, just a couple seconds here and there, just to tighten the pace a little bit. I maybe would trim a little bit of stuff at the beginning of the movie, because I think some of the Jar Jar stuff just drag a little bit. But overall, it's not as agonizing, as you mentioned, as people say it is. And I think a lot of that, our perception of this movie being, oh God, it's so terrible, is because we've been fed this for what feels like it's 20 years now. So yeah, so we've been fed this for 20 plus years that, oh, this movie sucks, this movie's bad.
Well, it's 22 years. Yeah.
You know what? It's not bad. It's not great, but it's not this death march into the abyss that everybody says it is.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, before we get to how the film held up, let's talk about favorite characters overall, main, recurring, guest, whatever. For me, favorite characters, I love the differences between Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan, that Qui-Gon is the Jedi Master, Qui-Gon is a little bit rogue, he doesn't always like to do what the Jedi Council expects of him, and he doesn't always like to go by the Jedi way. He goes by the Jedi way, but he goes just outside the lines, whereas Obi-Wan's like, but Master, this is how it's supposed to be done. Blah, 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 blah. I see Qui-Gon as a little bit of a rule breaker. I see Obi-Wan in this film as, you must follow the rules no matter what. Like, Obi-Wan obviously has not been able to come into his own yet in this. I love going back and watching this again. I'm just going to say this right now. In this movie, I love what Jar Jar does, because Jar Jar is a character who got introduced to us and he's learning from his mistakes. If you have a character that can constantly learn from their mistakes, even though later he will make the biggest mistake of them all, I really enjoyed Jar Jar this time around watching this. Padme is great. I love the double switch with the handmaiden thing and whatever else. I think that's cool with the decoys. Darth Maul doesn't do enough in this for me to actually call him a favorite character. I love the moment that the double lightsaber is revealed, and I haven't gotten to him I'm just now getting to the point where I was introduced to his race in the Clone Wars for season 4. So I haven't actually seen him yet, but it's like, I don't care about the character because he doesn't do much. Like you already said,
he's a marketing gimmick with a lightsaber. And I think that's his biggest downfall. Like, they had him hyped up to be this next big, he's supposed to be Darth Vader level badass.
Yep.
And you don't, he's honestly the most capable lightsaber guy before General Grievous. And even General Grievous doesn't get that much kind of screen time. Like, if the prequel trilogy has any real detriment against it, is its secondary villains suck. Like, Darth Maul sounds awesome. He looks awesome. He has a double-bladed lightsaber. He's kick-ass. Cool. Count Dooku sounds impressive, sounds regal, sounds royal. It's fucking Christopher Lee. He has two lightsaber fights, gets his ass kicked in both. General Grievous, awesome droid general. Okay, he has one lightsaber fight, has four lightsabers, gets two arms cut off immediately. Big deal. That's where the prequel trilogy falls apart. So I agree with you. Darth Maul, you're a cool idea, but you don't do anything.
Yeah.
The prequels, Darth Sidious is one of my favorite bad guys because at least through episodes 1 through 6, there's a consistent plan. You can see how things evolve. You can see how things are being manipulated. You see how bad things are eventually going to friggin' get at some point. But my favorite character has always been Obi-Wan. I love his attitude. I love the way he evolves throughout the series. And the big reason I love him is I love his lightsaber design. And there are subtle differences between this lightsaber design and the one he wields in Attack of the Clones, but you literally need close-up photos to tell. But I'm that much of a dork. Qui-Gon, I'm a huge fan of. Like I said, he really deserved more. screen time in the entire prequel trilogy.
Yeah.
And I really like Padme, again, a character who I think deserved a little bit better because they wanted her to be the next Princess Leia. She does get to do a little bit more in the other ones than be barefoot and pregnant somewhat. But again, there are arguments for and against her character. We'll make those in subsequent episodes. And I think Jake Lloyd as Anakin has occasional moments where he's the most comfortable. His stuff on Tatooine is really stiff.
Yeah.
I think his stuff in the Starfighter is his best stuff in the movie. And because,
yeah, in this movie, yes.
Yeah. Like he feels, I think the actor Jake Lloyd felt most comfortable acting in a Starfighter cockpit as opposed to acting against other people. I don't think that's a strike against him. He was a 9-year-old kid. I don't blame you. You're not going to be one of the great child actors of your era, and that's fine. But he's not as bad as everybody says he is. The amount of hate that that kid got was vastly undeserved.
And I never hated him. Even back when I saw the movie in theaters, the character is just beginning here. We're just seeing the beginnings of Anakin Skywalker. He's a little kid. He's a little kid who is told that he has organisms inside his organisms. Like, I mean, come on. You know, it's not the actor's fault. It's the way George Lucas wrote the damn script. If anything, if any fault is to be found in The Phantom Menace, it's solely on George Lucas's shoulders. End of story in my mind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. How the film held up. There's three things here, and then we'll go to the GCR and Universal Rating System for an overall rating of the film. Here are the three things. Did the film keep your interest throughout? Are you itching to watch the next film now? And would you recommend this film to people? So for me, this film kept my, even though I paused it a couple of times, it wasn't like, oh, I'm pausing it and then coming back 4 hours. I watched this within, not necessarily the full 2 hours of the movie, but within 3 hours total of starting it to finish, I finished this movie in one sitting. So there were only maybe one or two scenes that I kind of was like, okay, what else is on? But in general, I really dug my second ever watch of this movie. What about you,
Mike? It held my interest because obviously I wanted to be as informed as I possibly could be for this. It got me thinking back a lot to just older memories and things that had come previous to this and how it holds its place in my life in the fandom. Like I said, I'd probably trim it up in a few separate places. If I could lose 15 minutes out of this without losing much plot or characterization, I'd do it. I'd give this movie a solid 6.5 out of 10.
Hang on a second.
No. Like, the point I'm trying to get here is I enjoyed my time with it. I didn't hate it as much as I expected to. And I'm glad I watched it again because it sets the tone for the prequel trilogy.
Right.
And I'm glad I see echoes of episode one in things as late as The Mandalorian in this current year.
Right. Yeah. So are we itching to watch the next movie after watching this one? I am actually, for one scene only, I am dreading watching Attack of the Clones again. There just should not be that long of a love scene in Star Wars.
Ugh. See, I'm an Attack of the Clones apologist. I unapologetically love that movie. Again, there are massive problems with it, but I love the clone movie because I love clones. That's my thing.
Right.
But again, if I could trim episode two.
Yeah. Yeah.
Probably by about 15 minutes again. There's that magic number. That's what I would do. And I'd maybe re-edit a couple scenes here and there. But yeah, I'm a big fan of episode two. And that's the only Star Wars movie I did not see on opening day. Cause I think I was going through a really bad breakup at the time.
Oh, wow.
But yeah, I'm excited to go through the rest of these movies with you just because, again, I've got vast history with a lot of the toys and the marketing and all that stuff with it. So, yeah.
All right. Now, this is not the rating. The rating is after this. But after watching this again, would you recommend this movie to people?
I'm going to have to say yes, because it does set up some stuff, but it's almost, you can almost skip this because it does introduce ideas and characters that are very important to Star Wars. But ultimately, all it does is really set up Darth Sidious and Obi-Wan and Anakin. A lot of other stuff kind of just happens, and they're kind of just there.
Right.
Like, there are certain plot themes and character developments that will become important later, but I don't know. I mean, if you're going to watch the entire 9 movies, it's 2 hours and 15 minutes. What else are you doing during lockdown?
Exactly. For me, here's my thing, and this is why I wanted to do this, and this is a question I want to pose to the audience as well as you, is that we had no control over it, but growing up in the 80s, we got episodes 4, 5, and 6, and then in the 90s and the 2000s, we got 1, 2, and 3, and then in the last, you know, 5 years, wow, in the last 5 years, we've gotten 7, 8, and 9, or 6 years now, actually. Ugh, 2020 was long. You know, the reason why I wanted to do this series, the 12 months of Star Wars, starting with episode 1 and ending with, it's not ending, but going through episode 9, is because how would I recommend this to people if I was watching the story, if I could be able to watch the story in order 40 years ago? I would recommend this, that people check it out and see it, because it is the beginning of the story, even though you've already seen the original trilogy, most likely. If anyone hasn't seen the original trilogy, you must be living under a rock. But what I noticed again, before we get to the overall GCRN rating for each of us, is the little things in this movie have so much consequence and effect on things that happen in the future of the film franchise. And that was so cool to see where it all started.
Yeah, I think episode 1, when you look at its expanded universe stuff that kind of spider webs out into it, there's a lot of really neat connective tissue, because Darth Maul didn't become cool until Clone Wars and Rebels. And the books expanded it out. Another thing episode 1 did was showed, this is just my own personal opinion, when episode 1 toys came out, I remember there being a massive rush to people go to Toys R Us, KB Toys, when that was still a thing, were buying up cartloads of this. People bought episode 1 toys as an investment. Man, you can buy these things at flea markets mint on card for like $5.
Yep.
So yeah, like these things flooded the market.
Yeah.
And I think it changed the way the toy and collector markets looked for a really, really, really long time. But episode 1 also gave us a lot of really neat prop replicas. A company that I used to do some stuff with years ago called Master Replicas produced some incredibly high-end lightsaber replicas, like Darth Maul's Battle Damage lightsaber, which is a signature series. There was a Force FX double-bladed lightsaber that came out of this. Like, episode 1 gave us a lot of really, really, really neat things. And I'm really glad that it did. Like, I love the look of, like I said, the battle droids. I've always been a huge fan of, and I've always been a fan of the music from this movie. So episode 1 does a lot of things right, and I think it's time this movie gets a second look at, now that we've had 22 years of time to reflect upon its place within the entire Skywalker trilogy. Or sorry, 9 movies, whatever the hell that word is.
The Skywalker saga, essentially.
There we go.
Okay, so the GCRN Universal Rating System, it's 0 to 5 with half marks. I am going to give this a 3.5, and 3.5 according to our website rating, is good. And it says, issues are certainly prevalent, but so are the successes. Typically, there is one specific area of extraordinary achievement or multitude of quality moments that make the negative aspects relatively easy to accept. The failures are not necessarily glaring and are often a byproduct of design, though the difficulties one encounters holds your enjoyment back from reaching its full potential.
I'm going to go with a 3. Again, sets up some wonderful things that do spiderweb into like other properties, and it does have some flaws, some significant flaws, but this is not the thing that you were told in an internet video 10 years ago was the death of the franchise or the beginning of the end. And I am a prequel lover. I've got no problem saying that. Is this my favorite prequel movie? Hell no. But watching it again, it's not as bad as I remember. I appreciate what it's done. And I would love to get my hands on that Jar Jar Black series figure that's on store shelves right now. That's how much I appreciate that character now. Suck it.
Very cool. And I will probably do this every time we do a rating. So for Mike's rating for 3, it says average. While the overall takeaway is positive, you do not necessarily walk away happy. It does not extraordinarily succeed in any specific areas. If it does, it gets weighed down by something as equally unsuccessful. Though overall enjoyable, is easily disposable. And I think that goes back to your thing of you don't necessarily have to start with this film in the Star Wars film canon. You could start with something else. You know, but I just... I'm always a sucker for starting the story at the beginning of the story. Mm-hmm. And now that we have all 9 films, this is, whether we like it or not, this is the beginning of the story for the Skywalker saga. All right, we are going to take a quick break. You're going to hear some ads and some other stuff, and we'll come back with final thoughts and closing out the show after this.
Sir, a transmission from the planet.
Is Queen Amidala herself.
At last, we are getting results. Again, you come before us, Your Highness.
You will not be so pleased when you hear what I have to say, Viceroy. Your trade boycott of our planet has ended.
I was not aware of such failure.
I have word that the Chancellor's ambassadors are with you now, and that you have been commanded to reach a settlement.
I know nothing of any ambassadors. You must be mistaken.
Beware, Viceroy. The Federation has gone too far this time.
We would never do anything without the approval of the Senate. You assume too much.
We will see.
Dacian, the superhero webcomic. Dacian's got superhero antics and sexy girls. For action, comedy, mayhem, and more, read it now at Dacian.com. Dacian.com.
And now... through the magic of the Cybernet Space Cube, the computer repeats stories of the Transformers. Transformers, Generation 2.
Wrong. This is not Generation 2. This is Generation 1. Done right.
The year will be 2014, and from secret staging grounds on 2 of Cybertron's moons, the valiant podcasters prepare to reclaim their reputations. September 17th, 2014, the TFG2 podcast premieres 45 podcast episodes dedicated to all 98 episodes of the Generation 1 cartoon, plus so much more than meets the ear. Join TFG1 Mike, Pecan Court Michael, Optimus Solo, and sometimes Steve Megatron as they redo TFG1 and get it done right. You can find the TFG2 podcast on www.geekcastradio.com and iTunes.
We shall rise again.
By the power of Grayskull, I command the Jawbridge. Open!
The Powers of Grayskull series will cover every episode of all 4 Masters of the Universe cartoons. Join Optimus Solo and myself, TF2 and Mike, as we tell tales of Eternia, discover the myths of Etheria, become masters in space, and finally, Masters of Grayskull. We'll have a commentary on the Secret of the Sword film and a few other special episodes. You can find this 125-episode-long podcast in iTunes and on the web at geekcastradio.com. By the power and honor of Grayskull, we all have the power.
Yeah, I hope I didn't miss anything exciting.
On the Simplistic Reviews podcast, we talk movies. We talk TV. We talk.
Hello, Julie, what the heck are you doing?
Trying to make our spot sound more exciting by adding explosions.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you could have got the point across with sound effects, not the real thing.
Car.
Download the show on iTunes or at simplisticreviews.blogspot.com.
I'm sure your insurance company will cover that.
No, they won't.
No, they probably won't.
A communications disruption can mean only one thing. Invasion.
It is now time for our last words here inside Studio 2009. Before I close it, I close it out. God, I can't talk. Was there anything that we forgot to mention, Mike? Is there anything you were going to mention earlier that you didn't mention? Kind of put all those thoughts here.
Okay, so one of the things I'd love to talk about is toys, and I've talked about that a few times during this, and prop replicas. Star Wars Episode One as a collection does have some expensive pieces in it, but to collect this series of figures is, in my opinion, not overly hard and not overly expensive. If you want to collect Star Wars figures, it's probably one of the more easily found ones outside of a few carded examples that were maybe harder to find on card, that particular wave may have been hard to find. And if you're collecting things like high-end replicas from, say, master replicas, yeah, you're going to pay a bit of a premium, but you're also getting fantastic kind of quality with them. So eBay is a wonderful resource for you to look at if you're looking for any of these things. If I were to recommend anything specific to Star Wars Episode One, there is a Darth Maul piggy bank that's electronic that is really, really, really cool. And there's like another version, I think, that connects to a Qui-Gon and an Obi-Wan, and you hook all three together and they perform like a battle sequence, which is really neat. There's the Naboo Starfighter toy, which makes lights and sounds, which is really, really, really fantastic. One of the most expensive pieces in this line is the Royal Cruiser, and that will cost you a fair chunk just because it's an older vehicle. It retailed for $100 back in 1999, so expect to pay a lot, especially if you want a mint in box example or a complete example. There were several figures that were canceled in this line. I think only prototypes exist of those, which is I always love looking for prototype stuff, even though I don't have any of it. Ultimately, if you want something really cool, and if Episode One is truly your jam, it's not hard to break into the collecting scene for this. Sometimes even looking on places like Facebook Marketplace, you'll like see people selling this. And I know we're in the middle of the coronavirus thing, but flea markets, if you look around to the right vendors, you can find people selling Episode One figures on card. I've seen them as cheap as $5 within the last couple of years. So don't be afraid to ask. Don't be afraid to barter, with people for them. One thing that's kind of fun that I like is the Star Wars role-playing game. And there were books focused around Episode One, and I think it was the Wizards of the Coast, not the Saga edition. It was the book that wasn't shaped like a coffee table book. This was a more traditional book, had books that were based around Episode One, Episode Two, but there wasn't an Episode Three book produced, I don't think, or at least I didn't have it any. Actually, no, wait, that was the Saga edition, but never mind. But yeah, there are some really neat tie-ins to this that you can find and look into. There is an awesome Hot Toys Darth Maul figure that looks really nice. There's a Hot Toys Qui-Gon Jinn. So if you've ever wanted your own little tiny Liam Neeson, you can get them in 12-inch scale if you're willing to pay like $500-$600. Yeah, like there's some wonderful merchandise out there for like episode one. There's even a really cool Star Wars Black series, which is more of the Hasbro high-end figures. They're about $30 in Canada. I think they're $24 in the States. And there are some really neat battle droids and Star Wars episode one Obi-Wans. I think there's, and I'm 99% sure there's a Qui-Gon. So if this movie's your jam, you can certainly get high-end figures and high-end collectibles. Certainly recommend it. And as a fun piece, I don't know whether you can still track this down, probably on eBay, there is a battle droid super soaker. So if you want a water gun that looks like a battle droid gun, you can do that.
Oh, wow. Absolutely. My final thoughts for this before I close it out is I remember playing the episode one video game.
Oh, my God. I could talk about those for 15 minutes.
I hated the beginning of that game because you had to scale the palace wall by the waterfall. Oh, it was so friggin' hard. I hated that thing.
One of the best tie-in video games for Star Wars ever, hands down. Star Wars Pod Racing, not just on consoles, because it got a re-release last year in HD, but the one you could sit in at the arcade.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, like, it's awesome, and you can still find them in the wild. It's not often, but they're still out there. I've seen episode one pinball machines. There was even one of the weirdest tie-in video games I ever saw was Star Wars episode one Super Bombad Racing. So if you've ever wanted to play Mario Kart but use Star Wars characters, you can do that.
Yep.
There's also Star Wars like battle chess and everything. Like episode one had a lot of video game tie-ins.
Yeah, it did.
They're mostly on the original PlayStation. There's some on the N64. If you want the re-releases, you can get that on your Xbox One, PlayStation 4 and 5, the Nintendo Switch. And I think there's even a physical edition from Limited Run Games, which comes with a bunch of extra crap. I don't know whether it's still in stock right now, but take a look around. My final thought.
COVID-19 has come at a cost for many small businesses, but financial support is available from the Government of Ontario. From grants of up to $20,000 for eligible small businesses, to support for purchasing PPE, to rebates for property tax and energy costs, we are working to ensure our small businesses can keep employing people and serving our communities, now and when COVID-19 is behind us. Visit ontario.ca/COVID support to apply. Paid for by the Government of Ontario. COVID-19 has come at a cost for many small businesses, but financial support is available from the Government of Ontario. From grants of up to $20,000 for eligible small businesses, to support for purchasing PPE, to rebates for property tax and energy costs, we are working to ensure our small businesses can keep employing people and serving our communities, now and when COVID-19 is behind us. Visit ontario.ca/COVID support to apply. Paid for by the Government of Ontario.
Is if you want to learn more about Star Wars toys, I recommend the site rebelscum.com. They've got a photo archive of almost every episode one toy, even some of the canceled ones that I'd mentioned. There's a few omissions because I guess they just don't have photographs of those particular ones, but it's one of the most extensive archives out there. If you want to learn more, you can visit, I think if you type in the name Steve Stansweet, he's the guy who runs Rancho Obi-Wan or something like that.
Right. Yep. I remember that. Yeah.
Like it's worth looking into seeing all the neat props and costumes that exist from this movie that still exist.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, if you're willing to go down some rabbit holes or some cool stuff on YouTube, just look it up, man. You're going to find something neat from this movie that you're going to say, hey, I remember that. And that was cool.
Thank you for joining us here inside the studio. If you'd like to get in contact with us or leave feedback for the show, there are several ways to do so. Visit our website, geekcastradio.com, where you can comment on this and all of our other episode posts, as well as all the other podcasts that we do. Send an email to feedback@geekcastradio.com. Here are all the ways you can listen to us nowadays. Apple and Google Podcasts, Spotify, and of course, the home where our files exist, Spreaker. You can also use any podcatching client you choose. However, I prefer you use one of these. Leave the show's feedback in iTunes. Please do this. We are a new podcast still. We only have 13, 14 episodes, so leave us a review. Follow us on Twitter at Geekcast Radio is the network Twitter. At It's ITS Studio 2009 is the show Twitter. I am at TFG and Mike. What is your Twitter, Mike?
Okay, so if you want to follow me on the socials, my personal Twitter is at Birdman Dodd. That's also my Instagram and my TikTok. You can also find me on Facebook under Mike the Birdman Dodd. And yeah, just you can leave me feedback, Mike at ThisWeekInGeek.net. I'd love to talk Star Wars. We are doing a new actual role play podcast on ThisWeekInGeek.net right now. We're going to be starting Stargate SG-1 or Tactical Weapons Integration Group, where we play through the Wyvern Games version of D&D 5th edition with a Stargate skin. Maybe we'll do Star Wars, as I used to be with TerribleWarriors.com. We played through a number of prequel era adventures there. So, yeah, there's a lot of good stuff coming up from This Week in Geek and myself. So be sure to keep it locked to those socials, and I'm sure there'll be pictures of cats.
I'm sure there will. Become a fan on Facebook, or you can go to facebook.com/GeekCast Radio Network. You can also check out Studio 2009 Podcast, and as well as This Week in Geek as well over there on Facebook. Join us next time when Steve and I will be back talking about Burton's Batman. That's right. We have already recorded and talked about Batman 89 and Batman Returns. For now, I am TFG and Mike with...
I've been Mike the Birdman.
You'll hear us back in the studio soon.
What's that? Hey, wait! Oh, muy, muy, I love you!
You almost got us killed. Are you brainless?
I spec.
The ability to speak does not make you intelligent. Now get out of here.
No, no, Mrs. Stay. Mr. called Jaja Binks. Mr. your humble servant.
That won't be necessary.
Oh, but it is. It is demanded by the gods, it is.
COVID-19 has come at a cost for many small businesses, but financial support is available from the Government of Ontario. From grants of up to $20,000 for eligible small businesses, to support for purchasing PPE, to rebates for property tax and energy costs, we are working to ensure our small businesses can keep employing people and serving our communities, now and when COVID-19 is behind us. Visit ontario.ca/COVID support to apply. Paid for by the Government of Ontario. COVID-19 has come at a cost for many small businesses, but financial support is available from the Government of Ontario. From grants of up to $20,000 for eligible small businesses, to support for purchasing PPE, to rebates for property tax and energy costs, we are working to ensure our small businesses can keep employing people and serving our communities, now and when COVID-19 is behind us. Visit ontario.ca/COVID support to apply. Paid for by the Government of Ontario.